أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنما الصدقات فقراء والمساكين والعاملين عليها والمؤلفة قلوبهم وفي الرقاب والغارم وفي سبيل الله وابن السبيل فريضة من الله والله حكيم.
Zakat expenditures are only for the poor and for the needy, and for those employed to collect zakat, bringing hearts together for Islam, and for freeing captives or slaves, and for those in debt, and for the cause of Allah, and for the stranded traveler, an obligation imposed by Allah, and Allah is knowing and wise.
الله العظيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. My name is Barira Hanif, SDG's coordinator and deputy director, research projects, and I'm pleased to be the moderator for today's UN 75 dialogue on inequalities bridging the divide, hosted by the National University of Sciences and Technology, Pakistan. The UN 75 dialogues are a welcome initiative by the United Nations on its 75th anniversary for institutional dialogues on matters of pressing concern for humanity and soliciting solutions for the same. The outcomes of these dialogues will be submitted to the United Nations in the form of a report, and the UN may extract ideas from our dialogue to be presented in the UN General Assembly session this fall. Our dialogue today is hosted live over the web with a diverse set of panelists from different sectors of the civil society who will provide their perspectives on challenges related to various types of inequalities and their solutions. For today's discussion, our esteemed panelists include Ms. Tania Idris, Special Advisor to Prime Minister on Digital Pakistan Initiative, Ms. Romina Khurshid Alam, Member National Assembly and Member of SDG's Task Force, Mr. Saleem Ranja, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Education, and Ms. Nigar Tat, Founder, Digital Rights Pakistan and a TED Fellow all the way from USA. And joining from NUST, we have Rector NUST, Lieutenant General Naveed Zaman, our faculty members, students and staff, as well as alumni who are attending from all over the globe. I thank you all very much for being here today. To officially commence, I would like to invite Rector NUST, Lieutenant General Naveed Zaman, to deliver the opening remarks.
Thank you, Priya. Ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum. First of all, my apologies for this late start. Actually, thought maybe online is up and running by now, but I think it is still taking roots. So there were some problems of getting connected. So that is why we are starting off today. Sorry for that. It's my pleasure to welcome all the distinguished panelists, esteemed guests, global audience, those faculty, students, alumni from all around the world, administrative staff, who have adjusted their schedules to take part in this auspicious UN 75 dialogue, which is hosted by NUST. And as per the information available on the World Wide Web, NUST is honored to be the first Pakistani university to be hosting such a dialogue. And this actually, we got the impulse from the visit of UN Secretary General, Mr. Antonio Guterres, who visited us a couple of months back. And in fact, he encouraged us to be part of this dialogue, and that is how NUST proudly hosts the session today. UN 75 initiative launched at the 75th anniversary of the UN is described as a global reality check to spark conversations around building a better future for all. Discussions like today are being held across the world and in diverse settings to develop the first ever repository of crowdsourced solutions to tackle major challenges. And these will be in turn presented by the Secretary General to the world leaders and senior UN officials at the UN session in September later, this past year. And the theme of the forum in September will be the future we want, the UN we need, reaffirming our collective commitment to multilateralism. And to address this theme, we were given 7 topics and we had to select one, and thus chose inequality, bridging the divide. And the reason we did that was because we believe that inequality is the root cause or the mother of all ills, of all the global issues which afflict us today. The global economic system which exists is rigged in the favor of the rich. The rich become richer and the poorer become more poorer. Besides economic inequalities, discrimination exists in terms of uneven access to education, health, and digital resources. Similarly, at the social level, discrimination exists in the realms of gender, culture, ethnicity, and religion. And such inequalities result in financial and social exclusion of a sizable population of the globe. And there are examples abound, since the main topic is different, so we would not like to go into the details and why it has happened or is happening. That we leave it to some other time. But just to mention about Pakistan, where again the disparities are vast. 24% of the population lives below the national poverty line. 22.7 million Pakistani children aged 5 to 16 are out of school. 53% are financially excluded, and 50% have no access to basic health facilities. Similarly, women earn 34% less wages than their male counterparts. With such blatant disparities, we need reformation. And thus feels that the most effective way to address this widening gap of inequalities in any form is through access to education. The right to education for all. Realizing the importance of United Nations 17 SDGs, thus has adopted UN SDGs framework to monitor and improve the impact of contribution of NUST, not only in national socio-economic growth, but also in addressing such multi-dimensional global challenges. A dedicated SDGs alignment plan has been incorporated with a mission to implement and track the performance in SDGs across all major domains within NUST, namely, as you can see on the screen, academics, research and innovation, operations and governance, and collaborations with all the pertinent stakeholders. And as a result of these wide-ranging internal organization, NUST today proudly is the topmost ranked university in Pakistan in Times Higher Education Impact Rankings 2020. NUST has ranked first in Pakistan in 4 SDGs, as shown on the slide: quality education, industry innovation and infrastructure, responsible consumption, partnership goals, and it stands second in 7 SDGs. Overall, NUST has ranked among the top 300 universities out of 867 participating universities worldwide. Ladies and gentlemen, due to the commitment of NUST towards SDGs, NUST imposes a strict non-discriminatory policy for reducing inequalities due to gender, race, marital status, ethnicity, religion, financial background, disabilities, and is applicable to all matters of university employment, administration, admission to university academic programs, and other activities. As you can see on the slide, 30%, we have 30% of first generation students, which is one of the KPIs in the UN SDGs. And more than 30% of the enrolled students and 23% of the staff are females. The student populace comes from all parts of Pakistan, as shown in the slide, and even refugees are supported. We have 11 enrolled refugees at the moment in the university. The university also facilitates differently abled students in pursuing their education through technical support and classroom economic mix. These key figures and measures speak for our contribution towards bridging the disparities through higher education. Thus, joined hands with PPL, Pakistan Petroleum Limited, in an outreach program conducted in Balochistan and KPK, two of our little backward provinces. And in this inclusive outreach program, the aim was to induct talented but underprivileged students, especially women from remote areas of Pakistan, into various undergraduate programs. This program is being run since 2017, and we also included Interior Sindh in 2019. So more than 200 students from these areas are enrolled every year to prepare them for the highly competitive must entry tests. The next slide shows the income distribution of the student families. Based on the fact that 60% of our intake comes from middle and low middle income groups with income less than 80,000 per month, we launched NEED initiative to make NEST a NEED blind university, thereby supporting all such needy students. NEED initiative, through partnerships with NEST alumni, private donors and government agencies for funding, is currently supporting more than 1800 needy students, and which is happens to be the largest in any university in Pakistan. NEST also has been extensively working to expand its academic services to underdeveloped and underrepresented regions of Pakistan for the capacity building of the youth of these areas at par with international standards. Thanks to the government and army support, we have been successful in opening up our campus at Quetta, Balochistan, where the undergraduate classes have started to function since last year. NEST has thus achieved presence in all provinces of Pakistan, the only Pakistani university to have this honor, which is a laudable step towards ensuring social inclusion. NEST has also ensured digital access to education to ensure inclusive lifelong learning opportunities through digital libraries, online trainings and courses, digital access to labs and cloud services, etc. In the end, I would just like to conclude by saying that we require a collective approach towards recreation of society on the basis of generosity and cooperation to address the wide spectrum of inequality that exists in our society as well as globally. We are extremely grateful to all the panelists and also to all the attendees who have joined us today, and we look forward for your views, your comments, your suggestions, so that at the end of the day we can charter a collective roadmap to address these challenges. And I look forward to active participation from all. Once again, at the end, I would like to also thank UN for selecting us to host the UN 75 dialogue. And I would also like to extend my thanks to the audit department of NEST, especially the department led by research directorate and Bolira, which is hosting this UN led session. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now we would like to open the dialogue with our honorable guests here. For the viewers who are watching this session live, you can participate by typing your question and the name of the guest to which the question is being addressed on the chat box at the right of the screen. We will be taking your questions live, and selected questions will be asked to the relevant panelists at the end of the session. To begin with, my first question is for Ms. Romina. Ms. Romina.
Good morning, and all of the people, especially the UN, and especially special thanks to NEST, because NEST is not only a university. It's an institute which makes, you know, impossible to the possible. So many congratulations to Nesta as well. And here I would like to open my the introduction about as being a parliamentarian about the SDGs, what we are working on it. It's my great pleasure to share with all the people over here that as being the Pakistan Parliament, we are lucky to have a task force members and a proper secretariat on SDGs. And being a signatory to the Agenda 2030 Sustainable Development, Pakistan has also committed to achieve the Global 17 Sustainable Development Goals set by the UN. The National Assembly of Pakistan has established an extraordinary benchmark for the international community by establishing Secretariat of the Parliamentary Task Force on Sustainable Development Goals at the Parliament House. The SDG Secretariat provides technical assistance and support to the task force members through research, data and evidence and communication, advocacy and media outreach on all SDGs. Here I would really like to share this as well with my all UN colleagues and people who are listening and watching us, that NUST is the partner with us on SDGs, with the SDGs Task Force, and they're providing us help in different goals. Like if I talk about myself, so as being the co-chair of Goal 17 and on the Goal 11, so they are providing me their all sort of a support, and not only in that, in other things too. So if we talk about only the SDGs 11, is about making cities and human settlements inclusive, safe, resilient and sustainable for the people. As the UN explained, the challenges cities face can be overcome in ways that allow them to continue to thrive and grow while improving resource use and reducing pollution and poverty. The future we want includes cities of opportunities for all, with access to basic services, energy, housing, transportation and more. And as we all know that UN has defined 10 targets and 15 indicators for SDGs 11. Targets specify the goals and indicators, represent the metrics by which the world aims to track whether these targets are achieved. Below is original text of all the targets on SDGs. As we have a short specific time, I would really request to the NUST people who are here, the facilitator, to share this presentation or share these graphs with you. So if any future question will be related to that, so we would love to answer that. But in just to cut it short, because I would really like to listen more and would like to answer the questions. Here I would really like to tell, because more than half of the world's population lives in the cities. Urbanization is growing at a rapid pace. So both globally and in Pakistan, however, as people move to urban areas from rural areas, housing issues increase. Rapid urbanization has posed a problem on sustainability, managing these cities and providing safe basic services to all its residents. As a result, slum areas have been on the rise. In 2015, 30% of the urban population was living in the slums-like conditions. Nearly a billion people live in slum areas in cities. This does not include people living in inadequate housing, the poses are challenged for waste disposal and sewage system that either do not exist in these areas or unsafe and inadequate. From clean water to air pollution, life in slum poses a developmental challenges for governments across the world, hence making SDGs 11 an important goal to achieve sustainable progress has made and reducing the slum population. Between 1990 and 2016, the global urban population living in slums fell from 46% to 23%. Because here I also want to put a light on it, because as in my personal opinion, and as we have gone through with different research, that we do focus on different other goals like hunger, poverty, women rights and other things, but this is somehow we have felt that it's been very much neglected somehow. So we really want to focus on that. So, and for that purpose, we are focusing more on it. So urbanization, that's why I've taken this challenge as well. Urbanization is generally considered to be linked with economic growth. This trend has been witnessed particularly in developed countries where urbanization and economic growth and development occurred simultaneously globally. It is esteemed that the cities generate more than 80% of the global gross domestic product. The more urbanized areas, more employment opportunities. Cities are also considered to be centers of the innovation and entrepreneurship. So here in context of Pakistan, Pakistan has the highest rate of urbanization in South Asia. According to the 2017 population census, 36.4% of the population lived in urban areas. In 1998, 32.5% of people in Pakistan lived in the urban areas. So now the United Nations Population Division estimate that by 2025, nearly half the country's population will be living in the cities. So the major cities in Pakistan have slum areas, inadequate, unaffordable housing, deteriorating air quality, lack of clean water, substandard sewerage system, or a complete lack of it, shortage of school spaces, shortage of open green spaces in many areas, and other basic infrastructure issues being going through. So however, recent research suggests that the relationship between urbanization and growth is not automatic. Urbanization in many developing countries has occurred without growth, jobs, and productivity. The benefits of urbanization come through sound public policies of unplanned and unmanaged urbanizations. Have their consequences such as growth of urban slums, environmental poverty and equality. Pakistan too has a large number of urban challenges, clearly defined urban policies, a large number of challenges. So here we are trying our level best. We are trying to come up with the national policies, working on the strategies, using the local and the federal and all the urban and different other places, especially those institutes who are based, research-based, to come up with the policies, come up with the strategies. We are trying to come up with the level best. And in that, because in Pakistan, after the 18th Amendment, as the provinces have been authorized and they're having different authorities, so we are trying to collaborate with each other, because we are not having one federal unit of task force in the SDGs. In fact, we have in all the provinces. So it's moreover going to be interact with each other, and there comes the goal number 17, which we are trying to have more relations, collaborations with each other. So on that note, I would really like to thank once again NAST and the UN, for their these opportunities, and we're looking forward for the best policies, for the best practices by sharing each other, and looking forward to you. Thank you so very much, all of you, and thanks to Barira. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Romina. She has also been the co-chair on SDG 17 Partnership for Goals, and we agree with you that the first step towards reducing inequalities is to providing basic living facilities like access to clean water, energy, and living spaces. Now we have Mr. Salim Ranja online. My next question is for him. How do you think that access to basic education can assist us in bridging the divide? And what are the existing challenges in education sector, and how is the government trying to address these challenges?
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Mujhe bahut khushi hai ki NAST ne mujhe invite kiya, because NAST meri khwabon ki tabeer hai, aur usme main bahut zyada credit dunga General Abid ko aur Rear Admiral Nasir Ikram ko, ki inhone jo both of them amazing persons to make ideas come true, rather dreams come true. Hello.
Didi, we can hear you, sir. We can hear you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Or me NAST or ek situation me or NAST software technology ki park ki situation me. Agar aaj se 60 saal pehle Mr. Hewlett and Mr. Packard milke Silicon Valley bana sakte hain, to Mr. Naveed Zaman aur Mr. Nasir Ikram milke Pakistan ki Silicon Valley kyon nahi bana sakte? Aur inshaallah jo unhone process start kiya hua hai, mujhe yakeen hai ki ek din NAST software technology park जो है वो एक इंशाल्लाह इंशाल्लाह एक दिन पाकिस्तान की सिलिकॉन वैली बनेगा। Having said that, I would say कि जी मेरे लिए जो basic literacy है that is not an issue of SPG, it's not an issue of SPG number 4. For me, इसके लिए मेरे पास हुक्म या कमांडमेंट है इकरा बिस्मे रब्बे जी खलक से। The very first commandment of our deen is Iqra, or the very first institution set up by Muslims was Dar-e-Arqam. So having Iqra and Dar-e-Arqam in the history, having Iqra and Dar-e-Arqam in the blessings, koi concept hi nahi hai ki hamar padho. So iske liye 100% literacy of both deen and duniya hamara cardinal principle hona chahiye. इसके बावजूद वैसे मैं ये गुजारिश कर दूं, दुनिया में कोई कौम तरक्की नहीं कर सकी जिसने जो दूसरों की जुबान में सोचती और बोलती इंग्लिश। एक्चुअली व्हेनेवर यू टू मी मच मोर इम्पोर्टेंट इज that the right of every citizen, and according to the constitution of Pakistan, that is 10 years till the age of 16, the education is the right of every citizen of Pakistan, and the government of Pakistan and the constitution of 1973 as amended in later on, it is considered to be a cardinal principle of Pakistan's constitution. And any government, any institution which is not doing it is not actually following the constitutional obligation. To me, much more important is not discussing, not deliberating what should be done. I believe in Kennedy's theory, don't see what United States has done for you, see what you can do for United States. When I took over as Secretary of BISP way back in 2015, within a couple of months I realized that BISP is a wonderful organization. I have to do my duty, but much more important than my position as Secretary of BISP, much more important is Secretary of BISP Vasila Atali. At that time, around 500,000 children of best beneficiaries were going to school through Vasila Atali in 32 districts. Within 6 months, we increased it to 1 million. In next 6 months, that ratio went to from 500,000 in September, July, August or September 2015. By July 2016, that was 1.5 million. If 1 million children can go to school in 1 year, by the support of one government, federal government department, the total number of Pakistani out of children school is less than, it used to be 26 million, but now Al-Filan new report is around 20 million. So can we make a Herculean effort, just put our all efforts down and make it come true within, let's say, 3 years? After that, one of my very dear friend, Mr. Tariq Chima, who works for Light and managed grant from Qatar Foundation. Now, just one another example. Light has been able to send more than 800,000 children to school. So, Vasila Talim, which was in 2015, 500,000 children, now is close to 3 million children. 50 district has gone to 100 district. I'm sure in next 2 to 3 years, they will be hitting, inshallah, 10 million. We need one more thrust from provincial governments. Government of Punjab, Government of Sindh, Government of Rajasthan has done very good. Basila Talim is from 5 to 12 children. They have picked up the girls from class 5 to class 10. Other organizations can do it. The second most important thing is, do we need a metric degree in their hand or something else? NAFTIC has done a very wise thing, is metric tech policy. Metric tech policy is introducing a new metric, like metric in science, metric in physics, metric in arts. They are coming up, metric in medical. They are coming up with now concept of metric tech. Class 9 and 10, those children who are not want to pursue their career in medical or arts, they can go in metric tech. Starting from 15 schools this year, and inshallah next year it will be taking much. They will be technical trained. Indonesia in 2002 decided that the ratio of 20-80 of schools, conventional schools and technical schools will be reversed in next 15 to 20 years. We can do the same. Imagine if Pakistan, all of Pakistan's schools can convert adult literacy centers in the evenings to start with Islamabad, to start with FGI, to start with the Air Force schools, to start with cantonment board schools, and later on picked up with provincial schools. And the same are trained. In the evening, there are one or two rooms of them are turned into technical training schools. How quickly we will achieve this target? As we say, the taste of pudding is not into seeing it, actually eating it. The issue is how I will do it. We keep on discussing how we will do it, but the question from how we comes to I, that is a paramount responsibility for that. Because if I remember that on the day of judgment, I'll be asked whether you delivered it or not. Let's all of us who are listening to this or talking to this, take a personal responsibility. How many school have gone, how many children have gone back to schools because of my personal effort? Things will become much easier than today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. My question is for Ms. My next question is for Ms. Megat Das. How do you think that based inequalities can be minimized? And what roles could organizations and UN play in reducing such disparities?
First of all, thank you so much for inviting me to this much needed dialogue. And also thanks to the earlier speakers who added so much value to this conversation. So I have been working on digital rights for the almost the last one decade in Pakistan, and have been looking into not only just, you know, like the digital rights in general, but also in terms of internet accessibility and different other issues related to internet governance from the gender lens. And somebody who has been working as you know, like a founder of an organization, but at the same time have been giving my input at the international level and so many UN agencies as well, especially in terms of digital gender divide and also like other inequalities in the society. I feel that we are lacking in so many things in addressing inequalities in general in our society. I mean, I'm seeing so many relevant questions, which I'm sure that the other speakers would also respond to. But I think the goal should be the eradication of gender-based inequalities altogether by tackling the underlying issues that underpin these inequalities on the basis of one's gender. So often interventions to eradicate or reduce these inequalities are grounded in cosmetic measures, such as ensuring representation of a woman in a particular field, for instance. However, without a structural and fundamental change to the system that allowed and perpetuated for that exclusion in the first place, representation for representation's sake can often seem superficial. So that's where we need to be prepared for thoughtful interventions that get to the root of the problem and be prepared to do the hard work necessary for ensuring that the inequalities are addressed. For instance, I mean, I'll be talking about the field of technology. Women are woefully underrepresented due to gender stereotyping in STEM fields, and systematic hiring practices have that produced a male-dominated workforce. I mean, that's not just in Pakistan, that's actually around the world when we talk about the tech and gender. So nevertheless, these issues will not be simply solved by placing more women in the field. There needs to be long-term change that encourages women to take up STEM subjects, for instance, and changing work cultures that ensure safe workplaces free from harassment and where women's input is valued as much as men's. If we look at the digital gender divide in Pakistan, the divide is among the highest in the world. According to the Mobile Gender Gap Report 2019, that's called GSMA, Pakistan had the widest mobile ownership gender gap, as women were 37% less likely than men to own a mobile phone. So, however, the problem cannot be solved by handing out mobile devices to women, of course, but the barriers are both economic and societal. 31% of women who do not own a mobile phone in Pakistan report that disapproval from their family is the top barrier to owning a mobile phone. And I mean, I'll go back to the question where Ramsha in a chat box, she basically talked about the regions where, you know, which are usually not not being discussed, the regions in the for instance, former Fatah or interior Sindh or like really, really underprivileged rural areas of Punjab and Balochistan. So this means that even if women were to get access to a mobile phone without a larger shift in patriarchal attitudes, these devices can become sources of monitoring, controlling, surveillance, or even result in violence if any perceived indiscretion is observed in online spaces. And we have seen a recent incident where two women were killed in the name of honor just because their video was being recorded and then spread online, first through the mobile phones in a village, and then it spread so viral in the online space and being put up on the Facebook and other social media platforms. And at the end of the day, these women were killed because the so-called honor of the tribe was hurt. So lastly, I would like to point out that interventions geared towards addressing gender-based inequalities need to be intersectional. That's the main thing that we really, really need to focus, which is recognizing that gender is not the only source of oppression in women's lives, and that it can intersect with class, ethnicity, race, ability, sexualities, and geographical location. And I mean, I have been seeing all these questions coming into the chat box where somebody said, what about trans women? So organizations, the last point, which is like what the organizations like UN can do in such situations. And I think organizations such as the UN have an important role to play in addressing these inequalities, but they must understand that their intervention will be meaningful if they recognize that their role is best served when they work with communities and activists and movements on the ground. Greater collaboration with local actors who have experience in working on these issues needs to strengthen, and their feedback must be listened to in earnest. So that's from me for now, but I'll be looking forward to respond to questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Nigat, for such insightful overview on gender-based inequalities and inequalities in general. Now, I would like to ask Ms. Kamal Shazer for her views on the key legislative amendments which the existing government is making or plans to make during its tenure to address inequality in any form. So, over to you, Ms. Kamal.
Thank you very much. First of all, I would like to congratulate UN on its 75th year, anniversary and appreciate its initiative for arranging people-driven global conversation on how we can shape our future together. I would also like to appreciate and acknowledge the key role of NUST in playing to host UN 75 dialogue in Pakistan. I'm sure such meaningful dialogues will help us to find innovative solutions to tackle with global challenges. With the emergence of COVID-19, it is high time that we indulge ourselves in such multi-stakeholder and multi-sectoral discussions to fight against upcoming socio-economic crisis. I'm very pleased to have this opportunity to talk on one of the prevalent global challenges, such as inequality. There are many types of inequality, such as economic, social, and inequality of opportunity. The need to reduce inequality has been enshrined in Article 38A and Article 38E of our Constitution, and it remains a vital aim of the present government. It is pertinent to mention that the incumbent PTI government is pursuing a number of people-centric policies to reduce all forms of inequality as a whole. Under the leadership of Prime Minister Imran Khan, government is working consistently to reduce inequality between rich and poor. PTI government has launched one of the biggest and comprehensive SRs program for poor. It has four pillars, such as addressing elite capture and making the government system work to create equality, safety nets for disadvantaged segments of the population, jobs and livelihoods, and human capital development. This program is a great step towards creation of a welfare state aimed at reducing inequality, alleviating poverty, investment in people, and uplift of districts lagging behind in development. So SARS program plays an imperative role in curbing both economic and social inequality in our society. Besides this, government has launched National Youth Development Program, which is we call Kamyab Jawan, which aims to reduce young women and men's vulnerability and exclusion through a three-pronged approach such as jobs, economic empowerment, social engagement, and education skill development. This program plays significant role in creating new jobs and reducing income inequality and inequality of opportunity in Pakistan. Referring to inequality in access to education, PTI government has launched SR scholarship to enhance the access to higher education. Furthermore, government also launched national healthcare program and provided in staff share cards to reduce the inequality in access to healthcare services. All these initiatives aims at bridging the gap between haves and have not. It is important to highlight that women empowerment is the top priority of PTI's government. To empower women economically, the government has allocated 50% share for them in the Prime Minister Youth Loan Scheme, which reflects its commitment and dedication to the cause of women empowerment and gender equality. Government is also under process to bring an enactment on paid maternity and paternity leave in order to facilitate the working women. Another law titled the Enforcement of Women's Property Rights Bill 2019, enacted by the Parliament, is meant to protect and secure the rights of ownership and possession of women in property. These are unprecedented initiatives which conform to the international norms and practices. Surely a step forward to progressiveness, government is dedicated to take further steps for elimination of gender discrimination, safeguard rights of women to ensure them socioeconomic empowerment. Furthermore, transgender persons in Pakistan constitute one of the country's most vulnerable and marginalized communities. So government passed the Transgender Act 2018, which explicitly bans any discrimination against transgender citizens of Pakistan by employers, organizations, educational institutions, healthcare providers, transportation service providers and any private business or service provider. Similarly, there is another bill about these differently abled person, which is under process, and once the session will resume, that will be also passed by this government and the parliament. Government is taking step to mainstream the transgender rights in wake of coronavirus outbreak. Already existing social, economic and gender inequalities in Pakistan have further aggravated. So Ministry of Human Rights has ensured that its helpline Women Crisis Pakistan Women Crisis shelters remain operated during the crisis with specific protocols in to control poverty and inequality. It is important to mention that equality and justice are major building blocks for progressive Naya Pakistan, mainly emphasize on merit and equality for all citizens. So on behalf of the government, I assure that we will extend all possible support and facilitation to reduce inequality at all levels in Pakistan. At the end, I'm delighted to be part of such high-level dialogue forum, and I would especially like to mention that this dialogue will serve as an effective platform to strengthen alliances and advance multi-stakeholders and multi-sectoral partnerships for accelerating action towards sustainable development. I also hope that the outcome of this dialogue can be of assistance to build a better future for all. I thank you.
Thank you very much for your overview of Naya Pakistan. With this, unfortunately, Ms. Tania Idris couldn't join us. So with this, we'll move to the Q&A session. We had a very healthy participation from our faculty members, staff and students. They had posted many questions, but unfortunately, due to shortage of time, we are able to take only a few. So this question is for you, Ms. Kamal. Can you hear me?
There's
a question regarding policies for reducing professional inequality for startups, basically, and the widening inequality gap due to the COVID pandemic. Do you have any insights on this?
Did you hear about the kafalat program, the SAS kafalat program, which is specifically for the women? And almost 140 billion rupees being given to the women members of any family. So almost 87 lakh women we have covered by giving this SAS kafalat program during this testing time and challenging time of COVID-19. And that is specifically to reduce inequality when it comes to poverty and people living below poverty line. And the second question was about, sorry, can you repeat the second part? Hello?
The second part is regarding the widening gap of inequalities due to COVID pandemic.
Yeah, actually, there are many think tanks which are working right now because economically, obviously, the entire, it is a global challenge and majority of the economies have gone down. Similarly, the case with Pakistan. But the Prime Minister is determined and, to reduce inequality among the developed and undeveloped countries or developing countries. He has been continuously raising his voice on the international forum, especially to the UN Journal. So we are working on it, and this next upcoming session is very pertinent and important in that regard. And hopefully we will come up with some good resolutions and some good solutions to bridge this gap, because it is widening, that is for sure. We all know that, and it's a reality of COVID-19. It is one of the major challenges. But the government has all the will and all the determination to cope up with this emerging situation. So I would say that there are policy making going on, and the cabinet members are really working hard on it, and probably the next agenda of the cabinet might be having it. So right now, I'm not in a position to give a specific policy line, but obviously it is under process. So you'll soon be able to know about it.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Now we have this question for Ms. Nigat Dal. Nigat, how do you think that the role of social media can, what is the role of social media in bridging the divide of inequality, and how can social media as a platform be used for inequality reduction?
So I'm not sure if you know, social media can actually reduce this bridge the gap in the inequality, because I still feel that access to social media, especially after COVID, is actually a privilege to most of us sitting in their homes and working and can access really good internet. And what about the people who are in other areas where the internet connections, internet strength is really, really poor? So, some of us who have really good understanding of issues, they can use their, you know, a presence on social media while talking more. These issues maybe, or you know, the narrative now inequality or around SDGs, I think that should be mainstream. But I think the internet penetration, the internet penetration in Pakistan is actually around 35% at the moment, and that took the 15% increase when the COVID started. So it's very, very important to see how many people have access to these technologies. You know, who are these people? Who has privilege? So all these important questions need to be asked. But those of us who are on internet and who are using social media, I think we want to talk more about this and talk about those people who are voiceless and do not have access to these technologies or issues that they are facing in their particular region.
Thank you, Nikhat. My next question is posed to Mr. Saleem Ranja. Can you please describe the measures the government of Pakistan is taking to bridge the education divide and reach for far-flung areas of Pakistan? Could you please describe the measures government of Pakistan is trying to make to bridge the education gap and divide and ensure the outreach for far-flung areas of Pakistan in terms of education?
So that's a tremendous thing, and that is launch of Delhi school during the COVID days. Now the famous old digital divide, we are getting it closer to bridge it, because all the syllabus is available on right from 8 o'clock in the morning till 6 o'clock in the evening on one of the channels of ETV. ETV has got the best available coverage as well as the whole of the country is concerned. Many part of the country where other channels are not available, ETV is. And even in many parts of the country where cell phone penetration is not there, it is available. Second, HSE has welcomed the introduction of edX and Coursera. Many Pakistani universities have already now got free access to Coursera courses. Imagine a student as well as a teacher who has got the access to the best available universities graduate courses, and that too online. I am a student of history. History is my passion, and believe now I am myself a student of University of Virginia's two courses on history. And after studying history for almost 55 years of my life, Now I wonder why didn't I do it earlier? Why didn't I have the access of such MOOCs? I wish I had done it 20 years ago. Third, once we got to know this, we started enrolling it in FTE. You'll be glad to know that 25% of the teachers of FTE around there 9,000 plus 2,250 years of the last count are enrolled in Coursera, edX, American Board, or DigiSkill courses. Once the teachers will be enrolled there, we are I'm expecting, they say that Rome was not built on the first day. When Indus starts somewhere in the plateaus of Tibet, you don't know that one day this river will become mighty Indus. 2,250 teachers of Islamabad, FDE, another 2,000 plus teachers of FGI and Air Force schools. This ratio is going to avalanche a new era of teachers training and students awareness. Third, very rightly mentioned by Madam Shirin Mazari about the Kamyab Jawan. The concept is not what the colonialism did. The colonialism made the colonial subjects job seekers. What this government has very wisely done is making job givers. A program like Kamyab Jawan in where hundreds of thousands of students will be trained in such a way where they will be given training under NAVTEC and many trainings under in IT. And one initiative is President's Initiative of Artificial Intelligence and Cloud Computing, where those big guys who are making 8,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, in couple of years, they are making $50,000 in a year, $30,000 a year. We need much more stories like that. Pakistan is already the fourth largest supplier of freelancers in the world. One of the biggest, 150 million cell phones, 60 million smartphones, fourth largest English speaking population in the world, young population, and that too tech savvy population. Be ready for the next tech revolution coming from the land of the pure. One illustration of that. The biggest IPO in textile was Interloop, brought $40 million IPO. But one Pakistani guy, Mudassar Sheikha, developed app with the name of Kareem. When he went into the market, it fetched $3.1 billion, 75% more than Pakistan's biggest textile IPO. So now all things are very much there. What we need to is assemble them, put them on the track, and inshallah, sky is the limit.
Thank you very much. Now we have our next question to Ms. Rumina. How to bridge the rural-urban divide, especially in the terms of perspective of smart cities development?
It's a very relevant question and very important question. As I've already mentioned before as well, that we are working on it. We are trying to come up with the most of the relevant research, in that we have already requested NASA as well to
please turn off the
hello.
Yes, we can hear you now. Please.
Okay, fine. Did I have to restart it again?
No, it's okay. You can continue from where you just finished.
Okay, fine. So as we are talking about how to bridge the rural and urban, so in that, as we have seen, the biggest challenge is the climate change and economy too. So as per the climate is affecting on the crop, on the agricultural side, so many people who are, they just feel like to move from the rural areas to the urbanization for finding the job, finding the work and doing the labor and these things. So for that, we are trying our level best to bridge, to bring people from there to here and to have, first of all, the discussion. It's very important to have a discussion and came across to know the basic, not only the basic issues, those issues which can bring both people on one page, and to get the issues from them and how we can handle and how we can tackle and how the to make, because we, what we came across still know and we got from the research that we have to focus a lot on the urban on the rural areas, because we can work on those areas, we can work to bring more facilities or provide the skills towards them, because most of the people from the rural areas, their job is or their work is related to agriculture. So how we can bring the best sort of a small industries, SME sectors towards the rural areas, and how we can develop and how we can do make the woman more strong over there. And for that, it's very good example of the Angro. They have, you know, worked on that in that they are providing the farm facilities, they are guiding and they're educating. That is also we are trying to do, and there are several other examples of that which we are focusing. And if you talk especially in terms of perspectives of the smart cities, I think now it's time that we have to come up to make the rural areas more smart, because cities are already overburdened, overpopulated and over unorganized. So we have to focus and to bring the facilities and to do sort of a work in which we are trying to focus more and working along with the different research departments where and we have not, because it's not a small thing, it's a big challenge, a very big challenge, where we are thinking and we are discussing with the management, with the planning commissions, with other areas who those work is through the development sector more. So how we can develop, so in that regard we are trying to focus with different agriculture sectors, educational sectors and the small SME sectors as well. So in that note, we are just trying to bridge the people, and moreover important is to have discussion with each other and to came across to know, because you know most of the time what we do, we have seen and especially I've practiced that, you know, we just assume and we just come up the policy and we just try to implement that policy. But more important is to have the person who is suffering, to listen from the person, to get their perspective from them that what they want or what changes can bring betterment into their life. So in that way we are working and trying to work more. And I would love to have any suggestions from the panels, and please you can forward to me as well. That can help us more. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Rumina. Now we will move to the last question of the session, and this question is posed to Megat Dal. Megat, how do you think that how we can reduce the gender gap, and as we are ranked 151 in the gender parity globally, so any measures government or organizations to take in providing security for working women especially?
I think this is like a questions that should be responded by the people in the government. I mean, I can only suggest as somebody from a civil society or a citizen, but I think it's important to hear from them that what are the measures that they are taking, and most of them have already spoken about this. But I think there are like lots of challenges that the working women are facing. I mean, there is one comment that's been recurring on in the chat box that's basically about, you know, the working woman and their you know, the issues that they are facing around childcare. So I think it's really important to sort of, you know, like look into the issues where working women who are first of all the barriers and the hurdles that they have to face from the beginning, and then when they go into the workplace, you know, they're like inequalities that they face here. And then I think it's very important that not only the government who are now looking at the child care of the working women who are married and have children, but at the same time, I think there should be a push to the private sector as well to look into this issue very closely, and there should be, you know, some push by the government that so many women who get good education, when they get married, the first question is that they are the they are also the housemakers. I mean, the stereotype in the society. But the second thing is that who'll take care of the children when you'll go for work? So I think this is like the main issue where we, when we see, you know, gender gap in the workforce in Pakistan, that's the main factor where, you know, when people say that, oh, this woman is now getting married, so she won't be part of the workforce, of course, for the obvious reasons. And until or unless we address those reasons that why they aren't able to become a part of the workforce, I don't think that we can bridge this gap around the workforce. But I would also respond to one question which I feel is more related to my work, and that was basically around data protection and the digital security and cyber security. Somebody asked that question in the chat box, and I just like want to respond to that, that while we are talking about you know, all the digital stuff, technology, you know, like things that are happening in Pakistan, it's really, really good to see the developments in the tech sector, the Digital Pakistan initiative. Dani is doing so much work. And it's all good, but I think it's also very important that the human rights, the digital age, should also be the center of all these policies when it comes to accessibility, when it comes to digital safety of the people who are using online spaces and technologies. Government of Pakistan, which is very good sign, by the way, that in the region, first country who is now looking into the data protection law, the first draft it came in October 2018, and now 2019. Sorry, and now the final draft has also been released, and it's open for comments. So on the Ministry of IT website, and I would encourage people who are listening to this that please go onto the website, read the draft, give your comments. It's open for everyone in the comments. We are moving on to, you know, like this stage which, you know, we see really advanced laws around GDPR, for instance, that is being implemented in the Europe. And that's a very good example around it. I move on to that section, but I think it's very important that all of us should be part of these consultations, should be part of giving our comments, so that later when the law will be enacted, we shouldn't say that, oh, we didn't know this is something that was happening. And I think this is very important that now it's open for public. People who are interested in this subject, they should go on Ministry of IT website, give their comments, urge comment that the accountability and the transparency around data protection scheme on everybody, not only the private sector, but also the government sector and government bodies who collect data of cities like NAGRA, Safe Cities, and all other projects.
Thank you, Nikhil. We agree that we should ensure participation of all key stakeholders in the legislation making process. That was a really insightful remark. Ladies and gentlemen, we have been enlightened by our worthy panelists on various aspects of inequalities and ways to address those. We have had an enthusiastic participation from faculty and students and all people from all over the globe who aired a lot of relevant questions, but we could only take a few due to paucity of time. But I'm sure that today's session has given us the opportunity to contemplate on this growing challenge of inequality with a view to address those in our individual, but more importantly, institutional levels. This brings us to the end, and I would like to thank our esteemed panelists for making time to join us today and for providing their insights on the subject. And to Honorable Rector Nusk for his leadership, to the participants from within Nusk and outside, especially from our from the global participants from Sustainable Development Solutions Network, of which NUST is also a member. And thank you everyone for your views and questions, and once again to the United Nations for this wonderful initiative. We look forward to capturing the proceedings in our report and submitting it to the UN shortly. Thank you, and signing off from NUST.